This is Laura Palmer's studio, and we are here with renowned author Dennis Cooper, so just gonna have a conversation. I'm waiting for some coffee. I came across your work when I was 16, and it impacted me a lot, and it was because I was not necessarily dealing with those same things, but I had those thoughts subconsciously, and then to read it just was, you know, it impacted me, and I've been trying to, you know, find the reasoning with this axis between violence and sex.
I mean, I had the same thoughts you do when you were age, probably, that age. I don't know, were you frightened? I wasn't frightened of them. I never really felt like I had the body that was going to go out of my control and do something like they want to do. But it was like it was just what bothered me was that it was so utopian. Because I, you know, I care about people. I'm a moral person, and I'm not. So it's like it was just an impossible. It was like this impossible thing to do, and yet it was incredibly compelling. And that's what that line is what interests me. And that's why my work ends up so much being about you know, when it happens, is it real or not? Because you know it's like a construct. There's the characters construct or the I construct situations where it's possible. But when for it to be possible, all these other things are happening that make it seem that it's not realistic. You know.
He kissed his mirror image goodbye. When he emerged, newly kid-like, the dwarf and he improvised an absurd little scene that established the fairy tale narrative. The dwarf steered them into the kitchen. Maybe Chris was overacting a bit, because at one point the dwarf slapped his face for no reason at all. Chris pretended to cry, and when he wouldn't or couldn't stop crying, the dwarf grabbed a knife off the counter and stuck it in Chris. Nothing fatal. Still, the pain was a shock. It ruined Chris's concentration. But, oh well.
I don't know, I read Guide when I was like 18. Guide was probably one of the weirdest ones. The dwarf.
Yeah, well that's what
the dwarf one. I was actually in a cafe, I was at a Chinese shop in Pasadena, an old town. And when the dwarf situation was going on, I actually had to put it down. And I've never had, and Dennis, I'll give this to you as a compliment. I've never done that for a book ever in my life.
The dwarf did it too.
Yeah, where I have to like close the book and be like, okay. I need to give this a little break.
Yeah, that dwarf scene. I like that dwarf scene. I have to love that dwarf scene.
Two guys get together, or three guys, five guys, whatever, and but it's like it's centered, it's so ritualistic, and they don't see it that way, especially if meth is involved or GHB or whatever, but they need the porno in order for them to get aroused.
Right.
It's like this
right.
The centerpiece, it's like the fireplace, you know, of some sort, and that is the source of energy for their erotic energy. And what are they looking at exactly? And then there's this whole other thing with people not filming themselves having sex, but they're not really watching themselves. They're not really seeing themselves have sex. They're actually watching the LCD screen as they have sex. So it's like this weird narcissism that when I ask people about it, they think, oh, no, it's okay. It's great. You know, I feel empowered. But to me, I think it's more has to do something with something negative, narcissism, which is prevalent. Hey, we're all under that umbrella.
When I was doing a little research for my work and stuff, it was a period where I was asking a lot of people to talk about exactly what happened to them when they were having sex, like the best sex they ever had. And one thing that was really interesting is that a huge majority of the people I asked about, when what made them have an orgasm was imagining that someone else was fucking the person they were fucking.
So that they weren't there themselves.
Yeah, it was like, they weren't there. There literally was someone else fucking them, and they were watching them fuck them. Or, if it was someone they liked, they would imagine someone who was raping them, and which would make the person they were fucking become so precious and emotional and sympathetic and all these things and endangered that it would turn them on so much that they would come. It's like, it's not enough just to fuck them and it's you and me and I fucking you and my God, I fucking you and I'm coming. It's like they have to have all these other things in their head, you know, to make it to get to that point to where they can objectify someone so completely that they can get off.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's really interesting. And I use that in my work all the time.
Dennis Cooper's books are rarely ever adapted for film. To date, there is one feature film that has been adapted from one of his books.
In 2004,
Dennis began collaborating with director and choreographer Giselle Vienne. Together, along with musical composer
Peter Raymer,
they have created some innovative and challenging theatrical productions.
As a new possibility, I find this new venture that you're going into, and especially the collaboration with Giselle Vienne, to be very interesting.
She approached me. I didn't know who she was. I didn't know her work. I was still living in LA, and she just had liked my books, because my books are pretty well known here, and she just said, do you want to try? I was coming over to do a lecture in Leon. So do you want to come 3 days, you want to just try fooling around? And working on something. And she sent me some DVDs, and I thought it was interesting. And also she was working with Peter Raber, who's a musician and does Migo Records, and he's like, I love his music. So I was like, okay, sure, okay. So we got together and worked for 3 days, and we made our first piece in 3 days. It was really crazy. So it was like, we just really, obviously, clicked. That one, and then we did another one, and then I moved over here, and now we work together regularly. So, it's super interesting for me, obviously, because I write books and I sit in a room in my room with my computer all the time, and I don't ever socialize, or I don't have any input, and I don't have any, you know, it's like I'm like the God, all powerful God with my work, which is the anarchist, so that makes me uncomfortable. So, in a theater situation, you know, and it's very, very interesting the delegation of power. That's quite interesting. She's the boss, but you know, but So yeah, I really like it. I like and the way she works, we're all like collaborators. It's not like I write the text, I give them to her, and then she does a piece. It's like I'm there every hour, every day. I work, you know, every rehearsal.